Hi everyone and welcome to this new video about three-phase power circuits. In this example, example number 6, we will look at unbalanced system, unbalanced Y-delta system. In example number 5, we looked at the unbalanced Y-Y system. So this is actually our second example about unbalanced systems. In example number 1 to number 4, we looked at different configurations of the three-phase power circuits, and these were all balanced systems. So we now consider the second example about the unbalanced system. So we have the Y-connected generators or star-connected sources, and we have the load connected in the delta configuration. Now the following data is given about this Y-delta system. The phase voltages VA, VB, VC are all have the amplitude of 100 volts, and the phase orientations are 0 degrees, plus 120 degrees, and minus 120 degrees. So this is actually the sequence we use in this example, and also this in the circuit. Loads are given already in the complex expression, so these are the rectangular forms of the load ZA, ZB, and ZC. So you can see this is an inductive load, this is a pure inductive load, this is a capacitive load. Okay, so let's look at the calculations. So what we like to know is the following: A, total observed complex power by the load, S load, total supplied complex power by the sources, that is S source. So at the end, we will again compare these two, so that must be of course equal to each other. The S load must be equal to the S source, of course within the limits of our rounding of errors. So that will be verified also after the calculations of S load and S source. So let's start first with the question A. So what do we do? Well, let's start with the total absorbed complex power . Okay, we can write the S load as a summation of the apparent power absorbed by ZA plus the apparent power absorbed by ZB and also the apparent power absorbed by Z of C. So we can write the following. We can say S of ZA plus S of ZB and plus S of Z of C. And I can now determine each of them and sum the results, and I will have the Z load. So what are the formulas for calculating the apparent power for each load? Now there are different formulas, so we can use, for example, this. The S is equal to, in general, 1/2 times the peak voltage, so this is actually the peak voltage, times the peak current and the complex conjugate of that. That's possible. You might also use the following. You can also say it is the S is equal to, again, 1/2, and use the peak voltage, but use the magnitude of that square divided by the associated impedance, and you take the complex conjugate of that also. So we can use this formula or this formula. It depends on actually the situation. So let's look at the calculations for the S for each load. So what I would like to know is first, what is actually the load voltage? That will of course help me in both equations. So load voltage will be of course line voltages. So VL1 is the load voltage of ZA, VL2 is the load voltage of ZB, and VL3 will be the load voltage of Z of C. So let's start first with the calculation of the load voltages. So I have actually the following: VZ of A, which is equal to VB minus VA. Again, you go from this point to that point, that's actually your reference, and that's actually the current direction. So I will have the voltage here for VZ of A. Now that will be, of course, if you substitute the values, will be 100 phase of 120 degrees minus 100 phase 0 degrees. We have done this many times, converting from the polar representation to the rectangle, and again going from that to the polar expression. So I will leave the details out here. You can look at the videos about complex numbers and the phasors. This will result in 100 times the square root of 3 and a phase of plus 150 degrees, and this will be of course in volts. And in a similar form, I will calculate VZ of B, which is the load voltage across the this. So this is actually the VZ B, and I will also make this clear. This is VZ of A, and I will have here VZ of C. So let's go. What is the Z of B, which is actually from this point to that point? It is A minus C. So we have the VA minus VC, which is 100 phase 0 degrees minus 100 phase minus 120 degrees. Again, you follow the rules for converting the polar and the rectangular expressions. You will have 100 times the square root of 3 and a phase of 30 degrees, plus 30. Now let's move on with the last one, which is V of ZC, which is, if you look carefully, which will be V of C minus V of B. Now, substituting the values, we have the following. And again, converting this to the polar representation, that will result in 100 times the square root of 3, and the phase will be minus 90 degrees. Again, you can follow actually a pattern. The amplitude will be multiplied by a square root of 3, and the phases will be 150, so this will be increased by 30 degrees, 30 degrees, 30 degrees increase. So actually, you can see this also in the pattern. I have now the expression, complex expression for the load voltages, each of them, because these are required. This is actually the peak voltage. If I now want to use this formula, the second one, this will allow me to calculate actually the apparent powers directly, because I can use now the peak values for each load, and I can also take the complex conjugate of the load, and I am done actually for the results for the apparent powers. But before I can do that, I will first determine the loads in the polar representation. So let's write on the loads. What do I have is the following. I have the Z of A, which is 3 plus J4, which is, of course, converted in the polar representation, will be 5 and the phase of 53 degrees. And it's also in ohms. So if you do the same for the Z of B, which is just J2, which is exactly a pure imaginary value, so it will be 2 with the 90 degrees phased. And the last one will be 8 minus J6, will result in 10 and a phase of minus 37 degrees. Now, if I now use the amplitude of the given load voltages in this formula and the complex conjugate of the associated impedances, I will have the following. So let's move on. Try to see everything in one place. So let's a little bit zoom out. Okay, so let's move on with the calculation of the S of ZA, which is again 1/2 times the peak value. Peak value is always 100 square root of 3, and you square that, so you don't bother about the phase, that's just the amplitude, times the divided by the complex conjugate of this expression. So what do I have is the following: 5, and the phase will be minus, so opposite, minus 53 degrees. And if you calculate this correctly for the first one, you will have 3000 and a phase of 53 degrees, of course, in volt amperes. Now, if you now do the same for the VZ of B, which is again 1/2, and you will take the amplitude, which is exactly the same, so 100 times the square root of 3, and you square that, and you will divide by 2 phase, again, takes the complex conjugate, will be opposite of the phase, will be minus 90 degrees, so be careful of that. With that, so we have the expression for that will be 7500, phase will be plus 90 degrees, and will be also in volt amperes. So if I move on with the final one, which is the S of Z of C, which is 1/2 times the amplitude squared, load voltage amplitude squared, divided by the 10 phase, it will be, of course, plus 37, because I'm taking the complex conjugate, will be opposite sign, so it will be 37 degrees, and this will result in 1500, and with a phase of minus 37 degrees, and that's actually the expression for each of the apparent values. So what do I have? If I take these two together, I will have the following. So the S of the load will be 300 phase 53 plus 3000, I mean, with a phase of 53, and 7500 with a phase of 90 degrees, and plus 1500 with a phase of minus 37 degrees. And this is, of course, all in volt amperes. If I now convert this again in the rectangular expression, why do I do that? Why do I need this? Because I need to add, and if I want to add two complex expressions, I will have to convert the polar expressions and the rectangular expressions and add them up, add the real parts and the imaginary parts, and then again convert to the polar expression, and then I'm actually done with the expression for S load. So let's do that also. So S load will be 3000, and it will take the cosine of the 53 degrees and also the plus J and the sine of the 53 degrees. So the results are actually the following. You will have 0.603 plus, and you will have the J, that's for the sine term, that will be 0.799, and that's for the first part. The second part will be 7500, and again take the cosine of 90 degrees, it will be 0. Cosine of the the sine of the 90 degrees will be 1, so we will have J just here. So the next one will be 1500 as the amplitude, so I will take that out of the brackets, and I will take the cosine of the minus 37 degrees, will be 0.799, and I will also take the sine of the minus 37 degrees, will be minus J, will be 0.602. Now what you can see is the following. You have the real part and imaginary parts for each polar expression. If you now add them all up for the real part and also group the imaginary parts together, and you will have a simplified expression for your rectangular expression, will be 3004 plus J, 8993 volts amperes. Now if you convert this to the polar expression, of course we can do that with the already known formula. So you will take the square root of the squares for the real and imaginary parts. So I will show this also here in more detail. So you will do this, and you will take the arctangent of the ratio of the imaginary part and the real part. So if you do the math here correctly, you will have 9,481 and a phase of very close to 71.5 degrees, and it will be also in volt amperes. And this is the absorbed power. So let me write it down. This is the total absorbed complex power by the loads. That's actually done for the first part of the for this analysis. Again, let's look at the situation of power factor, which is also interesting in power circuits. So if I now want to know the power factor, PF, which is of course the cosine of this phase, which is already calculated here, but this phase is positive, so it will mean actually that we have a lagging system. So it will mean 71.5 degrees lagging, and this will be, if you do the math correctly again, will be 0.317 lagging. Of course, it wasn't a question in place, but just to give you more information and more background about the situation. So we have quite a lot lagging actually in our load. Okay, so let's move on with the next question, which is, if you look at the question again, we have done this A. Now we have to calculate the supplied complex power by the sources, and of course this will be S source must be equal to the S load. So let's move on. A little bit zoom out here, so I will move to S sources. So total supplied complex power by the sources. Okay, so let's move on with the situation for the source. So as source, we can again use the superposition principle as we did for the load. So the summation, what we have used here for Z of ZA, of S of ZA, S of ZB, and S of ZC, can be used also for this system, because we can say what is the supplied apparent power, complex power of the VA, what is that for VB, and what is that for VC. If you know that and add them up together, you will also have the total supplied complex power. So I will do that also. So I will have the following expression. I will have the S source will be equal to S of V of A, S of V of B, and S of V of C. So I will again calculate each of them. So what do I have? I have, of course, these two equations again. We can use this expression or this expression for the apparent power. But this one, the second one, is actually not really handy here, because I don't know the impedance of the system or the source itself. So I am actually stuck with this one. I need to know the peak value. I already know that, which is already given in the equation. But I also need the peak current. And now is the situation, what is the peak current? It's actually the current supplied by each system. So if I now draw here the current, it's actually the current supplied by the VA, which is the phase current IPA. And this current for the B will be the phase IPA, IPB for the source B. And for the source C will be I phase of C. So I need to know these three currents and take the complex conjugate for each of them, and I can move on with the calculations for each of the apparent powers for the loads. But I can already recognize something. The line current IL1 will be exactly equal to IPA, and the line current IL2 will be exactly equal to IPB, and the line current IL3 will be exactly equal to IPC. Now, what do I know about the IL1 and IL2 and IL3? At the moment, not much, but I can already say this current is actually can be calculated or can be written in the terms of the load current. So the load current for the ZB, IZB, minus the load current IZA will result in IL1. In a similar fashion, I can use the IL2, which is this current, IZA minus IZC will result in this. Just apply at these nodes Kirchhoff current law. At this point, I will do that also, so I will have IL3 will be this current IZ of C minus IZ of B. So I will use that. Of course, I will first calculate each of the load currents, so that's actually the first step. And then using this these load currents, I can calculate the line voltages, line currents, I mean. From the line currents, I can just equate them to the phase current, because they're exactly the same. So first step is determining the load currents. So let's first determine that. So what are the load currents? Let me write down here to save some space. So load current. So I will start with IZ of A, which is of course VZ of A divided by Z of A. And what is VZ of A? VZ of A is actually just a line. Let's move on here. You already have that. That's just a line voltage. So I can just take this and use it in the expressions for the load voltage. So I have the following. This will be 100 square root of 3 phase of 150 degrees divided by ZA was 5 phase 53 degrees. So if I now do the math again, it will be 20 square root of 3, and the phase will be 97 plus 97 degrees, and it will be in amperes. Now the following IZ of B will be VZ of B divided by ZB. Again, same procedure using the associated load voltage and the load itself. So the impedance of that is the 2 ohms with 90 degrees phase will be, in this case, 50 square root of 3 in a phase of minus 60 degrees. and it's actually also in amperes. So the last one, IZ of C, which is VZ of C divided by Z of C, which is 100 square root of 3 again with the amplitude, and the phase was minus 90 degrees. So if I now also substitute the impedance value, well, with 10 minus 37 degrees, will result in 10 square root of 3 and phase of minus 53 degrees. So I know I already have the all of the load currents. Now I can use the expression what I just discussed about the line currents, because the line currents are again exactly equal to the phase current. So now the line currents, let's move on with the line currents. So I will just make some room. So line currents IL1, which was equal to, it's already given here, so IL1 will be equal to IZB minus IZA. So let's look at it again. If you remember, IL1, we just move up, IL1, this one will be this current IZB minus IZA. So I will use that here. So if I have IZB and IZA, I can calculate this. Let's also do that for IL2 and also for IL3. So we have the template already ready. So IL2 will be IZ of A minus IZ of C. And for the last one, IL3 will be IZ of C minus IZ of B. If you now just substitute those values, which are actually given here, and convert all the expressions again to the polar form, you will have, for the first one, will be 119.3 in a phase of minus 67 degrees in amperes. And the next one will be 50.40 in a phase of plus 107 degrees. And the last one will be 69.45 in a phase of 118 degrees in amperes. All of them are done. Now we know the line current, those are actually the required values for the calculation of the phase current. The phase currents are exactly equal to each other. So the phase currents, I will also denote them here, the phase currents I will have the IP of A, which is just IL1, just add that simple, and IP of B, which is IL2, and IP of C, which is just IL3. Now I need actually the currents IPA, IPB, and IPC, and I will take the complex conjugate. So I will actually need this to move on with actually the calculation. So what I have the voltages for each of them. For this, I also need the current. So if I now continue with the apparent power, so if I have now SV of A, which will be 1 over 2, so the half, times the VZA times the VA, times the I phase A, which will be this one. So I will use this formula for each of the apparent powers. So what is that? If I now substitute the value, it will be 1/2 times, will be 100 phase of 0 degrees, which is actually the first phase voltage, times, and if I now take the complex conjugate of this, will be the same amplitude, but it will be, of course, the opposite sign, will be 119.4.3 phase of plus 67 degrees. Now, if you do the math here, you will have 5,965 and a phase of 67 degrees, of course, in volt amperes. Now, procedure is exactly the same for the other two. So we'll have half times the VB times the phase current of source B. Now, substituting the values will be 100 volts with a phase orientation of 120 degrees. and I will take 50.40, and the phase will be minus 107, because I will take the complex conjugate. I will have 2520 and a phase of 13 degrees, and it's also in volt amperes. The final one, Vc of C, which is 1/2 times the V of C times its phase current and a complex conjugate of that. Again, 1/2 times 100 volts minus 120 degrees, taking the complex conjugate of the associated phase current, Ip of C, which will be 69.45 phase minus 118. And this will result in 3473, and with phase of minus 238 degrees volt amperes. Now, I am actually almost done. I just add them up. I will add these three calculated values. So what do I have? I have the S source will be 5965 phase 67 plus 2500. So 2520 phase 30 degrees plus 3473 phase minus 238 degrees. Now, if you do the math here, again, the same procedure, we do that on and on. What we would like to know is we will convert this polar expression to the rectangular, add the all real parts and imaginary parts, simplify, and then convert to the polar expression. So what you have is, in the rectangular form, we will have, if you do the math correctly, and you will have very close to this, because it's also rounding off errors. So we have 2,946 plus J, 9,006 volt amperes. And if I now convert this to the polar expression, which I did also for the load, what I have is the following: 9,476 phase of 71.9 degrees will be, of course, in volt amperes. Now, look, if you now compare this, I will just a little bit zoom out. What we had for the S load was this one. So it was 9,481. I have for the, I'll zoom out a little bit more. So what do I have? I have the source is this. So I mean load is the 9,481, and I have 9,476. Just an error of 5 volt amperes, but it's just due to the rounding errors. It's not a very large error. And the phase is almost exactly the same. So it's 71.5, and it's here 71.9. So it's actually almost the same. So in total, we can say, so conclusion actually in total, in effect, or you can make a note better. So note, S source will be S load. And this is interesting because you can verify your calculation if you have an ideal system, which is actually also for this system. If this is not exactly the same as the S load, or very close to S load, of course, then you made somewhere a mistake. Otherwise, it will be a completely a system with a, some transmission line losses or other losses. So that will be also used for verification. All right, so we will move on, of course. So don't forget to subscribe, to stay tuned, and share this video. And I'll see you next time. Take care.